Dorico, the advanced music notation software from Steinberg.
Hello and welcome to Sing the Score. How's my hair? It's as well to check as I discovered while filming for Live from London last week.
Yeah, in central London. So, well, it's
someone who's... I think we should start. Your hair is standing up on end.
See, that's the professional I'm really thinking.
And, I mean, you look really clever.
On we go with episode 29, and bravo, brava for tuning in to a composer that isn't that well known, Ignazio Donati. But the piece itself is an absolute corker. Suspensions, naughty chords, and a ravishing performance by five wonderful singers. Kira Hendrick, Matthew Long, Greg Skidmore, Charles Gibbs, and the honeyed tones of Hugo Hymas on the alto line. In Renaissance music, that's the high tenor part, as we keep saying on Sing the Score, and that was Donati's own voice as well. Donati was an almost exact contemporary of Monteverdi, born 1570 and died 1638, though the paths don't obviously seem to have crossed. Monteverdi worked in just three main centres, Cremona, Mantua, and then Venice. Whereas Donati moved around a great deal. Urbino, Pesaro, Fano, Urbino again, Ferrara, Casalmaggiore, Novara, Lodi, and finally Milan Cathedral.
Le due cupole grandi della cattedrale di Milano.
You can't help wondering whether he kept getting sent to new places with really good references just to get rid of him, or whether he was just gradually working his way to musical institutions with more and more influence. Donati seems to have published no madrigals or secular songs. This is because he was a church musician through and through. He seems to me to have been someone who knew exactly what he was doing and completely versed in the day-to-day practical business of providing music for sacred institutions that had quite varied and different needs. This is important because he wanted his music to sell. So, for example, his Salmi Boscarecci from 1623 includes instructions for how you can perform the music in different ways depending on your forces, reducing the number of singing parts if you're a more modest institution, or actually doubling up the choirs at different places in the church if your institution had
loads of money.
A contemporary of Donati, Lodovico Viadana, had already spoken about this approach of doubling up choirs if you've got the money, to put them in different places in the church to increase the sense of grandeur, in the preface to his Vesper Psalm settings of 1612. E. Fagellini recorded that set back in 2012, and we had a lot of fun allocating the four choirs to soloists, choir, and groups of instruments, and generally experimenting with layout. Donati, though, is getting personal.
If there's a shortage of sopranos, the soprano part can be sung down the octave by tenors.
How rude!
Well, soprano here meaning the person who sings that part, whether nun, boy, falsettist or castrato.
That's okay then.
But Donati makes a further suggestion, that if you're short of a bass, to pop the bass part up an octave and have it sung by an alto, this high tenor part. I love that. The idea that you might not have enough common or garden basses, but that you've got a spare high tenor lying around. Don't people know what high tenors cost? Donati's music is very little published, but the gem that we're going to tackle caught my eye a few years ago, and E. Fagellini subsequently recorded it as part of a Monteverdi Vespers reconstruction in 2017. It's called Dulcis, Amor, Iesu, and it's from Donati's very first publication from 1612, the Sacri Concentus.
Thank you.
This is good stuff. And even though it's only his first published volume, and just for five voices and organ, he's very keen to tell us about an unusual phenomenon.
Phenomena.
That he's been working on, which is called...
Cantar lontano.
Singing at a distance.
Isn't that one for the times?
In which, to create a beautiful effect, Donati specifies the separation of the singers around the church, some distance away from the organ. And this shows a new thinking, modernity, and certainly in Donati's case, a desire to...
move away from the ordinary.
Just to be clear, this isn't multi-choir music in the style we know from Venice with the Gabrielis and others, though it's presumably inspired by that and happening at the same time, but music for just five singers and organ.
This style has been experimented with by me and by my singers in the Cathedral of Pesaro and wherever else I have been.
So here's a composer, not from the most famous musical institutions of the time with the best choirs, but still experimenting and adapting the split choir or multi-choir technique that he would have heard about from Venice, perhaps even heard firsthand, and making it work for his congregations by separating the singers in his church, even just five singers at a time.
Can you please go over there, please? Thank you very much.
Whatever happened to the separation of the classes?
Donati includes certain of the pieces in the 1612 publication for singing in this style. But he also points out...
almost all of these pieces have been sung in this manner, though I have not wished to impose this as a condition, as not all singers will be sufficiently capable of singing at a distance.
He continues, and try to picture this happening.
The arrangement is as follows, for only the first singer needs to be within sight of the organ. The others, whether they be three, two or one, must stay far off from the organ, separate from each other, unseen within the body of the church, as is the practice with multiple choirs.
Donati makes much of the cleverness of this idea, the illusory effect, the fact that the congregation won't be able to see the singers, the sound coming magically at them from all corners of the church. So last week, Yves Angelini was rehearsing in the Voces 8 Centre, and we had a first go.
So I just happened to find Barney Smith hanging around the building, as normal. To ask you first, Barney, what did it feel like to be in the middle of that?
Surprisingly, it was nice, but that's not surprising, I should say. But surprisingly, not as ideal as I would have thought. You know, this idea that we have a surround sound in the modern day is, of course, what we were going for, but to me it felt disparate. I expected to enjoy it because they are solo polyphonic lines, but it just didn't feel like the whole that you expect from a choir. And part of the reason I love to listen to a choir is because of that sort of team game, and it just didn't have that, and I would actually have taken that over this idea of 360.
Right, get out, that's no help at all. If you like to sing, we've not done this before. We've done shows like Full Monty already before where people are split up. But what did this feel like? Matt, was it new? I couldn't see you at all, you were behind a pillar.
I was desperately trying to do three different things. Follow Greg, listen, and use my arm, and sing, which was remarkably difficult.
Yeah, unfortunately I was relying on Matt as a conductor, so I was utterly hopeless.
And Rebecca, you were at the front, if you like. You and I had contact. Only one singer, according to Donati, is meant to be able to see. So you had it easy, did you?
No, because I had the horrible pressure of starting everything off. And I found I was terrified, less about singing the music, but beating completely in the wrong way. Despite it's literally, you have one job, you beat one and two. And far too stressful. Don't do it again.
Interesting. So, that's the idea in the bin then.
Thank you very much.
So the singers were clearly quite unnerved by having to beat time at the same time as singing. A cheat that I thought I'd try out, as Donati does say that the singers won't be seen by the congregation. Actually, Donati says it's really about listening. But that's very, very difficult in Renaissance churches with any kind of delay. Barnaby Smith, not that impressed, but I wonder whether I could convince him over time. I've heard quite a lot of polyphony like this. Notably through two John Labouchardière shows with E. Fagellini called The Full Monteverdi and Betrayal. I enjoy the isolation of the polyphonic lines and the melodic intensity it seems to draw from the singers as a result, once they've got used to it. It does involve perhaps a slight looseness of rhythm, and tuning won't be as good as it can be when singers are close together, but that can be a price worth paying, though it wouldn't do for every day, and it's interesting that, as far as we know, it doesn't seem to have caught on particularly at the time. As always,
it's simply a case of shaka, arse on gout. Have some madeira, madeira. Oh.
There are certain things in Cantare Lontano singing that Donati advises. Back then, singers mostly sang from individual part books with just their own line. And he recommends that you should have the organ line written in as well, so you can more easily follow where you are. He also says that
the organist must help the singers by avoiding shortening notes and maintaining a consistent rhythm.
In other words, if you're in charge of the rhythm, don't get all arty and expressive and bendy with it when people are trying to follow you from meters away over the other side of the church. One thing about this style is that it is more suited to polyphonic singing than chordal singing. Imagine it, if you're in the middle of the church, voices coming at you polyphonic, lovely, but just chords doesn't quite make sense. Anyway, if you're still unable to sing at the moment, this might be a good idea to treat this as an opportunity.
Disaster didn't stymie, Louis Pasteur.
No, sir.
Edison took years to see the light. Right.
Alexander Graham knew failure well. He took a lot of notes to ring that bell.
So when it gets distressing, it's a blessing. Onward and upward you must press. Yes, yes, till up from the ashes. Up from the ashes. Grow the roses of success.
Grow the roses.
Grow the roses.
Grow the roses.
Mind you, I didn't see them singing separated. You can get scores of this particular piece and others by Donati from Prima la Musica. And if you're interested in learning more about Cantare Lontano in general, there's a recording and an essay here by an Italian group that made quite a study of it. The text of our piece is one of those impassioned outpourings very much inspired by the Old Testament book of the Song of Songs, the intimate, at times erotic, outpouring of love between the bride and the bridegroom, which the Catholic Church read as an analogy for Christ's love for his church. Sometimes, if the text wasn't obviously religious enough for composers setting it, they'd add the odd word to make it okay, as in, my beloved is as a bundle of myrrh that lies all night between my breasts. Alleluia? For our text, you could well imagine it as a secular poem if you replaced the word Jesus with, for example, the name of a shepherd.
Jesus, my sweet love,
my sweet treasure, my beloved, I languish for you. Pierce me with your arrows. I would die for you, O my Jesus. You are my hope, my light, my life. You are infinite goodness.
The presence of arrows reminds me of St. Teresa of Avila, the Spanish mystic from this period, whose dream about an encounter with an angel is certainly of this type.
I saw in his hand a long spear of gold, and at the point there seemed to be a little fire. He appeared to me to be thrusting it at times into my heart and to pierce my very entrails. When he drew it out, he seemed to draw them out also, and to leave me all on fire with a great love of God. The pain was so great that it made me moan, and yet so surpassing was the sweetness of this excessive pain that I could not wish to be rid of it.
That would be an ecumenical matter!
Blimey, has it got hotter in here? You may be thinking what I'm thinking, but what we need to appreciate is the intensity of religious devotion in a piece like this. And the interesting thing is that composers used exactly the same expressive lexicon, the same gestures in setting intense religious texts as they did in erotic texts. Monteverdi even reprinted some of his erotic madrigals with religious texts in the early 17th century with the help of a priest in Milan called Coppini. And I remember going to a lecture by John Butt at the University of York when he talked about Bach doing something not dissimilar. Donati's piece is about longing, and that's set up from the very start when the second word,
Amor,
moves on to a dissonant note, which to us feels sweet and full of
Amor.
But also, it's moved from the opening chord, G major, to A major. Now that's just one note higher, but two harmonic steps up the circle of fifths. That's the order of the keys you get by adding an extra sharp to the key signature, raising the tension. So you start on G, add one sharp to the key signature, move to D, then another one, move to A. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, it doesn't matter. The point is just that it's not just the pitch that's moved up, but the harmony itself that has immediately moved 2 degrees of tension upwards. That's why all of a sudden,
it's getting hot in here, so take off all your fur.
The phrase finishes with Dulce bonum dilecte mi, my sweet treasure, my beloved, with a very spoken feel. Dulce bonum dilecte mi. And then a counter melody, I languish for you, langueo pro te, which creates a languorous suspension against the spoken-y bit. The voices now start pairing up, creating interesting dissonance, which embodies this feeling of longing. And then a third motif, which back in the 1980s would have been expressed as
hit me with your rhythm stick, hit me, hit me.
But in the 16th century, pierce me with your arrows, sagittis tuis, confige me. And you can see the path of the arrows on sagittis going up the page, ba 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 bum, and then confige, pierce, creating its own piercing dissonance. Confige me. And with these three little phrases, we build up quite a steamy atmosphere. At one point, Donati doubles up the languishing, that languor motif, with now two singers suspended, double the fun. Then adding a shower of arrows in different voices to take us to a suitably dissonant cadence, which seems to have been written expressly for that Bernini statue of St. Teresa. Next, it's I Would Die For You, O My Jesus, Moriar Pro Te, with another suspension, another one. It's disgusting, really. Just look at that higher note over the first Moriar, which comes in second, making that lower note into a suspension. And you need to aim that top note higher than you might guess for that suspension really to ring. Now, we all like really leaning into a suspension. It's all part of growing up and being a choral singer and nothing to be ashamed about. But we do tend to push down on them with the top note because we can feel that gravitational pull from the note underneath that got there first. But you've got to aim higher and get enough distance between the two notes. This motif is then worked around all the parts until Donati's final idea. Tu spes, tu lux, tu vita, you my hope, my light, my life, you are infinite goodness, bonitas infinita. And enjoy the moment that the alto sings this. That's the high tenor, Donati's own voice. Nice to imagine him singing this. For the climax, with all five singers, Tu Bonitas now becomes a real feature. The motor that drives that five voice section is the same sense of push and pull with harmony that we had at the opening when we moved from G, Dulcis Amor Iesu. Because in Renaissance musical theory and generally in music, if you add sharps, you increase the tension. So C, no sharps, G, one, D, A, E major, four sharps, marvellous. And then the other way, E. A, three sharps, two sharps, D, one sharp, G, C, and then even back down to F and B flat. And the last phrase of that section goes C, add two sharps, D, add two more sharps, E. And then having reached the summit of religious passion on E major, it's take them out again back to D, than to see. The old lags of Sing the Score amongst you may have noticed a little thing I've missed out there. Donati doesn't just go from C major to D major, does he? No, in fact, the harmony drops a third before moving up. And what do we call a harmonic shift of a third?
It's tertiary shift!
Seriously, the audience, folks. Okay, here we go. Our next question from a very lovely contestant here. What harmonic progression shifts up or down a third with one note common to both chords?
Dominant seventh?
Is the wrong answer! The correct answer is tertiary shift!
Please, make it stop.
I was saying earlier that this sort of hyper-expressive, very passionate style is exactly the same musical way that secular texts were set as well. For example, Monteverdi's highly erotic Si ch'io vorrei morire, which we covered in Sing the Score episode 6, which is suspiciously the most watched of all the episodes. Singing a madrigal overtly about sex is nothing to be embarrassed about. It's all part of growing up and being Italian. If you're a choir director trying to make performance decisions about this piece, what exactly are your tools? Well, let's open our toolbox. No, hang on.
Renaissance conductor toolbox. Number one, text.
Your first job is to ensure that your singers know what they're singing about. If you think I exaggerate this, then just look at the number of editions of Renaissance music that don't even bother to print a text and translation. We're so wound up in dirty chords and the glorious sound of the thing that text often doesn't get the time it merits. Remember, text is where the composer starts.
Renaissance conductor toolbox. Number two, dynamics.
In music of this sort, it's fair to say that there's some sort of correlation between high and loud. It's practically the same word in Italian, alto. That doesn't stop you doing the opposite if you're absolutely determined not to. But it is natural for a singer to be louder at the top of their range, and composers seem to write for this, putting moments of greater passion at the top of the range. A useful corollary to that is that if a passage is written for three voices and then repeated with all five voices taking part in a harmonically richer version, then the composer is probably imagining the full five-voice version as slightly louder. These are just starting points, but worth bearing in mind.
Renaissance conductor toolbox. Number three, tempo.
How much can you bend the tempo for expressive purposes? The singer Caccini talks about speed and bending tempo in the context of solo song and other writers for other types of music. It'll always be a matter of taste, but bending the tempo is inherently interesting as humans we respond to change. And if you're moving to sharper keys, as in that tu spes phrase, then the increasing tension implied there could be accompanied by perhaps a little accelerando, getting faster. And then as it goes back to flat keys, the opposite. But be careful when you get slower. This is often overdone. Don't bend the tempo so much that in fact the tempo is broken and you can no longer feel the harmonic movement. In my book, that's less expressive. So the motto, bend, not break. You should always be able to feel the movement of the harmony.
Renaissance conductor toolkit, yeah.
But there's
just one thing I don't understand.
Right at the start, the phrase languio pro te has two different instructions for what harmony to accompany it. On one, the figure in the harmony implies that the keyboard should follow the voice. Sounds like this, and keep your ear on the accompaniment. But elsewhere, the figure doesn't change, and that would create more dissonance. There's only one thing for it.
Who you gonna call?
The Victor Hotline!
So does the organ follow the voice, or not?
I'm not entirely... Hang on.
Victor Hotline.
This isn't about Victor, it's about figuring. Can you still help?
We possess the key to all the secrets of polyphony. What do you need to know?
Ignazio Donati, 17th century Italian.
We know who he is. What do you want with him?
It's a motet, Dulcis, Amor, Iesu. Should the organ part follow the vocal line, or stay simple and create dissonance against it?
Are there original figures?
Yeah, but they may just be Donati's publisher, and half of them show you to do it one way, and half of them the other.
Wait. Start a trace.
Who disturbs me at this time?
Victor Hotline, we have a figuring issue.
Speak.
In Dulcis Amor Iesu, should the figuring change with the voice or stay simple and create dissonance against it?
Who wants to know?
It's Fagiolino again.
Again? Can he not decide for himself? Does he have no opinion? Is there only one way of doing things? Specialists. They're so intent on finding the one true path that they miss the greater truth. That self-knowledge comes from trying all paths, except country dancing. What's that noise?
Nothing. Nothing.
Are you trying to trace me?
No, of course not. Continue.
There's nothing to continue. He should read the advice to singers in my book. And leave me in peace. What is this? You fool!
And amazingly, you too can have a Victor Hotline t-shirt or a hoodie. What's a hoodie?
Dad!
Just visit our fairly pointless but nicely niche shop, where you can also buy a Last Supper mug, probably a foot warmer or something, and in the latest addition to our incredible range, a SingTheScore pencil. Behold, touch it, write with it, own it. Amazing what they can do. Look, it's got a little rubber on the end. Marvellous. We guarantee you'll be the only member of your choir with such exclusive items, whatever you buy from the shop, because frankly no one knows about it and barely anyone knows about Sing the Score. Which reminds me, it would be great if you could share this show with one of your choirs. That would be really helpful at the moment. We're not exactly going viral because, of course, we're doing the niche. Also remember please to donate to the cost of making these at efagiolini.com/friends. That's it. Here's Greg with the warning.
Dude, seriously. Here's what Donati did actually say about singing in the book that Vader was talking about. Hold the head high and look straight ahead with the mouth half open. Force yourself not to arch the eyebrows, nor move the lips, nor to make unseemly gestures with your face, but see if it may be possible to execute the ornaments with the larynx, for this is the true way. Okay.
Oh.
Sing the Score is supported by Dorico, the advanced music notation software from Steinberg. Get started with Dorico SE, which is completely free to download and use. Check it out today at steinberg.net/dorico.